I am really chuffed that Mike has managed to get hold of a Mini Moke. I don't think he realises quite how much of a fan I am of these cars. It's one of those things I've always wanted to get my hands on, and really, this is a bit of a dream come true. I love the cheeky, uncomplicated design. I love the utterly basic yet totally functional mechanicals. It's also a car that shouts fun, so I'm hoping it's going to be fun to work on.
And my first job is to add something to the basic spec of the car. I'm going to swap out the rubbish standard fan for a thermostatically controlled electrical one.
I know from many years of tinkering with old Mini engines that this little plastic cooling fan in here sometimes isn't quite up to the job. Now, the fan is attached to a water pump, and the water pump is attached to the crankshaft. So when the engine is spinning over nice and fast, you're zipping down the motorway, the fan is spinning fast enough to draw enough cooling air through the radiator to cool the engine properly. Unfortunately, at idle, the fan is barely moving, so it doesn't really suck any air through and therefore doesn't really cool the engine very well. Now, if you compound that problem with slow traffic and a hot sunny day, you really are asking for trouble. Now, I know Mike hasn't complained about any problems with the cooling, but that might not always be the case with this car.
To install the electric fan, I need to remove the radiator, as the new fan will be attached to it. The first step is to drain the cooling system, and the water coming out of the rad is a very worrying shade of black.
It's got to be said, that water's not looking that clever, is it? Now, I think the reason it is that kind of dark black colour is because probably in the past, somebody's gone for a quick fix, had a few leaks perhaps in the water system. They've put this additive in, and the idea is that little rubber particles find their way to any leaks and plug them up so you can get home. Problem with that is that also you could end up plugging up the galleries inside the radiator, so we may have to change that as well.
The radiator cowling needs to come off, giving me just enough access to unbolt the fan. Once that's undone from the water pump pulley, I only need to move the air filter out of the way, and the radiator should just slide out.
Well, I managed to get everything out of the engine bay at last. Having a look at this fan, first, we can see it's had a bit of a hard life. There's big chunks missing out of it, so it's quite a good reason for getting rid of this. Now, if I have a look at the radiator, now you can see there's a hole that's been filled in either with this sort of stuff that was in the water or perhaps with some kind of chemical metal. So obviously if it's got a leak there and they've had a few issues, I think its best thing to do is just to get rid of this standard radiator. So to this end, here is a new radiator. It's actually a high performance one. It's a two-core radiator. The idea is you can get more water through it. It's going to do much more cooling. So again, it's going to keep our engine cooler. It actually looks and is pretty much the same dimensions as the old one. So of course, this bit of shrouding will fit straight over, which is lovely. And of course, then we're going to need a fan. So here is our electric fan. Okay, it is made out of plastic, but it's much kind of harder plastic. It's much firmer, so it will hold its shape and do a much better job. And we just pop that into position. It's going to be held onto here with this bracketry, like so. So once I've bolted all that on, I can pop it into the car. Now, because the fan, the new electric fan, is going to be on the outside of the radiator, I need to make a little bit more room in the engine bay here. So I'm just going to use this little slide hammer and just ever so gently just tease it out. There we go, simple as that.
Overall, swapping over a fan and rad costs £180 all in. And it's a doable job for a home mechanic. Garage labour on the upgrade would run to £100 or so. The new fan kit includes a thermostatic relay to switch it on and off. And here it is, housed in sexy aluminium.
Now, of course, this has to be in direct contact with the water, otherwise it's not going to know what temperature things are. To that end, we've got this nice silicon hose here that comes with the kit. And you can see a little bit of aluminium thread sticking out the top. If you look inside, you can see the other half of that. So it's like a kind of a big washer almost with a hole inside. So of course the water's flowing through there. And I've got a special little washer here with a funny shape in it. So when that washer goes into position on the hose and then is crushed into place by the thermostat housing, it actually forms almost like a little O-ring out of the hose itself, which is rather clever. So it's a nice, perfect watertight seal.
The fan needs power, so with the battery disconnected, I cut one section of wire to length, attach one end to the relay, and the other is connected to the Moke's fuse box. Now I top up the coolant using a 50% antifreeze and water mix, and we're nearly in business. I need to run the engine up to temperature so the mechanical thermostat will open. Then, any air trapped in the cooling system will bleed out through the expansion tank, which I'll leave open for the time being.
So now it should be running at about 80, 90 degrees. If I just get my little screwdriver here just to adjust the resistor that sets the temperature, if I just wind it... There we go, look at that. I've just turned the fan on. So now, theoretically, if I just now wind it back off so that the fan turns itself off, there we go. So now what should happen, rather than overheat, is that when the engine gets too hot, the fan will kick in, cool it down, and it should run beautifully forevermore.
Fantastic.
When Mike first showed me this car, he really felt that we should do something about the colour of this roll bar, the bull bars and the wheels. But I've talked to some Moke experts and they are strongly advising that we should leave it in the colour that it left the factory, which is white. So unfortunately, Mike's just going to have to lump it and our white bits are going to stay white. Something I will attend to, though, is the state of this rather tired-looking roof frame. What I think I'll do is get it powder-coated. But while we're talking about the roof, of course, Mike complained about that as well, and the condition of the seat covers. So I've talked to a trimmer friend of mine. He can sort it out for us. So my first job is to take the seats out.
Removing the seats is as easy as, undoing four bolts. The rear seats need to be unlaced and then slide off over the deck chair-style frames. The saggy roof peels off and will be thrown away. You can buy a replacement hood off the shelf, but there are four series of Moke and all differ slightly, so I'm going to get one custom made to make sure it'll fit. The cost of £600 or £700 is actually about the same as an off the shelf one. This frame will be stripped of rust when it's taken to the powder coaters later. Before that, I want to see if the Moke's underside also needs a bit of TLC.
Mike promised me that this Mini Moke is a mini miracle because it's got no rot on the underside. Now, obviously, I was really sceptical. It's a really old car and it's lived by the seaside. There's bound to be some nasties on this floor pan here, but as it turns out, it's really solid. It's in really good condition, except for this little bit just here, which is what Mike pointed out to me. Now, obviously, I need to cut out that rot, put in some good metal, and then make sure that the underside of this car is blemish-free.
Fuel vapours get on rather too well with welding, so before I do anything with sparks, I need to remove the petrol tank, which is hidden in the outer box section of the Moke.
If I just undo this observation panel on the side here, just two quarter turn fasteners. Inside here, there's a wire that goes to the sender. Just pull that off, and then there is the actual hose, or the pipe itself, for the fuel, so that's disconnected.
The fuel filler cap also needs to come off, and then I undo all but one of the bolts that hold the petrol tank in place.
Now, I don't know quite how much fuel is in the tank, so rather than risk it falling onto my head, I'm just going to use this transmission jack to take some of the strain.
And with the final retaining bolt undone, here she comes. The tank is now out of the picture. It's time to attack the rust. After removing the paint with a grinder, I make up a steel repair panel, which is obviously larger than the rust I'm removing. I score around it, then use a cutting disc to make a straight, clean line around the damaged area. Then we can get welding. Top tip, a magnet will hold the new panel perfectly in place for the first couple of spot welds. I now weld the rest of the join. Then I grind off any excess weld and give our metal a nice smooth finish. All it needs then is two coats of rust-proofing primer and some paint.
Now, rust is a known enemy of the Moke, and I've just eradicated the only hole that we could find on this car, so I think we're doing pretty well.
Click here to subscribe.